to check those out. We're going to move quickly to Dr. Carmela Alcántara, because I believe she does have a, we have a deadline to get her out by 2 p.m. So Dr. Carmela Alcántara is going to speak to us today a little bit about one of those five areas that Michael Granier was just speaking about, which is a focus on community-led interventions, okay? So Dr. Granier explained that there are some researchers that are the pointers and some that are the fixers. So some people point out the problems and others try to fix the problems. Both are important. But Dr. Alcantara's work is really focused, I think, this area that she's going to talk about, on some of the fixing and what can we do to help make change. So are you there, Dr. Alcantara?
I am. Hi, Julie.
Hi. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm going to pull up your slides.
Happy to be here, and thank you again for the invitation. I've been listening in since one, and you know the energy is super exciting, and it's always great to follow Dr. Granier. So as Julie mentioned, what I want to do in the short time together is just highlight one of these kinds of community engaged interventions, and specifically this is the Dormir Mejor trial, which is an ongoing R01 that's a hybrid effectiveness implementation study, but that's focusing on a health disparity population that's important, which is the Latinx population, and particularly Spanish-speaking Latinx population. Next slide. So really quickly, a roadmap. I just want to share just one slide that's going to provide a 50,000-foot view about what do we know regarding behavioral sleep medicine interventions targeting health disparities populations. I'll then go in to talk about in my program of research that focuses on insomnia in the Latinx populations and what we know about digital therapeutics and cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia, and really just set up the rationale for sharing with you some really exciting work that's currently going on now that I think leverages a lot of what's already some of the principles that have been discussed to date. Next slide. And so to first, you know, to answer this big question, which is what do we know about the state of science of behavioral sleep medicine interventions for health disparity populations, my group and I, we conducted this really comprehensive, exhaustive, systematic review that reviewed all of the behavioral sleep medicine randomized control trials from inception to December of just last year, where the goals were to examine all the records, to examine and identify the socioeconomic characteristics, to get a sense of the representativeness of the sample, and then also to really closely look at what kinds of changes, cultural adaptations or tailoring were made for these specific populations that I think were highlighted in what Dr. Granier described before. And then lastly, to describe really qualitatively intervention effectiveness, if you can advance. Julie. And what we found from that is that over, I think we retrieved 8,000 records, did full deep dives of 800 articles. And of those 800 articles that met inclusion of criteria, only 7% of them actually targeted underserved groups that would qualify as a health disparity population. And if you advance next, Julian, you can just advance again. The among this, you know, massive systematic review, what we learned is that of behavioral sleep medicine randomized controlled trials, none targeted immigrants, none targeted LGBTQ plus populations, linguistic minorities, so non-English speakers, and that only about 9% actually targeted or included racial ethnic minorities. In my program of research, I appreciate being called a fixer. I think I describe in point two and some really interesting in how social determinants shape sleep, mental health, and cardiovascular health, but also thinking how do we translate that into interventions. And you know, Michael put in a plug for thinking not only about individual level interventions for community interventions. And I've been really interested in how do I integrate the work on these population-based level with both, you know, individual behavioral level interventions, and increasingly focus on insomnia in the Latinx population. Next slide, please. And the reason for that is if you take a temporal view, the prevalence of insomnia among the Latinx population is actually increasing. So in 2002, it was around 16%. In 2012, it's about 19.3%. With insomnia, as all of you on this call know, we know that in terms of behavioral treatment, CBTI is the first line of defense. And so we know what works really well, but that there's a lot of barriers to actually getting access, receipt of cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. Next slide. And some of those, which we all know, and you know, include insomnia secondary, there's inaccurate beliefs about the importance of sleep, this limited access to qualified providers, which when you're referring to underserved groups and non-English speakers really becomes accentuated in terms of who is having qualified providers to deliver CBTI in languages that are not English. And in general, as that systematic review, the results of that systematic review underscored, there's been a lack of attention to these contextual language literacy and cultural factors. Next slide, please. And so with that in mind, you know, I and colleagues have been very interested to understand the role of sociocultural stressors and its relationship to insomnia and other sleep disturbances among Latinx populations, and use these large population-based studies, some of which Dr. Granner called out, like the Hispanic Community Health Study, to examine what's the relationship between specific sociocultural stressors and insomnia. And what we have found in two sets of papers that were published is that acculturation stress in particular, which is the stress of adapting and integrating to U.S. mainland culture, seems to be a pretty significant, consistent, and robust correlate of insomnia in the Latinx population. We've also had some in this work to show that also ethnic discrimination appears to be an important correlate of insomnia as well, in addition to chronic and independent of chronic stress. So this bore out in quantitative, population-based epidemiological studies, and also in qualitative work that we did, where we directly talked with patients and participants with insomnia. And time again in these groups, both in English-speaking groups and in Spanish-speaking groups, this the salience of acculturation stress was actually very salient and pervasive. Next slide, please. And there's been a lot of promise. It's cool and not intentional. I think I heard in the PCORI talk there there was reference to several of these internet-based studies or digital health-based studies to address potential CBTI access barriers, particularly because of the supply and demand imbalance that we all know. And there's been a lot of excitement around digital therapeutics, which I'm referring to here, or digital treatments, as potentially expanding access for underserved communities because of the supply and demand issues. Next slide, please. We know that this might be especially helpful among Spanish speakers, and there might be a potential for faster uptake of behavioral health care because of increased access of digital health for these communities. Next slide. This is just an example, by no means an exhaustive list, not an exhaustive list of various different kinds of digital therapeutics for insomnia that exist, and some of which have a pretty strong evidence base. Next slide, please. And so this, you know, the quantitative literature that I showed you, the qualitative literature, the promise of some of these digital therapeutics and the strong evidence base for CBTI in particular among English speaking high SES communities really served as a strong foundation to fund for the Dormir Mejor study, which is an AHRQ, Agency for Healthcare Research Quality, R01 funded grant that reflects a collaboration between Columbia School of Social Work, Pear Therapeutics, which I'll describe, and also this 11 person bilingual English and Spanish community advisory board that includes patient stakeholders and other key stakeholders from the community and other respective areas. Next slide, please. And so with this hybrid type 1 trial, it's a hybrid effectiveness implementation study, as I mentioned, with three aims. The first aim is to culturally adapt an existing evidence-based digital health intervention and then to conduct a randomized controlled trial. The second aim is to conduct a multi-stakeholder evaluation to really understand and assess the barriers and facilitators to implementing a digital health CBTI treatment in primary care for Spanish-speaking Latinx patients. And the third is a cost-effectiveness aim. We want to know, is it cost-effective? How does it compare? Next slide. And so using a rigorous cultural adaptation sub-study, that goes from the early stages of information gathering and very formative qualitative research to the final stage, which is this cultural adaptation trial, this randomized controlled trial. We're currently in the stage 3 and stage 4. I do want to say we have a lot of participant engagement and have been able to conduct focus groups in New York City during our surge in May through virtual platforms. And I think that's a reflection of just the community involvement that we've had thus far and are prepared to move to stage three and stage four. But a community advisory board has been involved throughout this entire process. Next question. Next slide. So in this intervention, the digital therapeutic that we are adapting and testing is Somryst. Somryst is, some of you may know, Somryst is the first FDA market authorized prescription digital therapeutic for chronic insomnia for adults ages 22 years old and up. It's really quite exciting. And so what we're doing is doing a deep dive top to bottom review of Somryst and obtaining both community advisory board and participant feedback on precipitating and perpetuating factors of insomnia, the Somryst vignette characters and stories, the personas, the guidelines, really with close attention to health literacy and wanting to make health literacy and numeracy. Often numeracy is actually a topic that isn't often discussed, but that given in digital platforms, you're relying on content, wanting to make sure that that we're attuned to and responsive to health literacy concerns to make sure that the therapeutic concepts are understood. Next slide. And to date, in this short and trying time, we've already identified 71 different kinds of adaptations. Most of these are what we would refer to as deep level adaptations or tailoring, where it's beyond just the language or more surface level adaptations. And some examples of these of adaptations, which are either surface or deep, include making sure that the vignette characters reflect the diversity of the Latinx population, that the video vignettes leverage cultural values of familismo, and I can talk more about that later, really centering the immigrant experience. As I mentioned, acculturation stress in the quantitative work seems to be a major factor in the qualitative work, so making sure that that was foregrounded throughout the content of the digital health intervention, incorporating culturally relevant examples and proverbs, and really, again, attuning to health literacy, to reading level, so all the materials at the sixth grade reading level, and also ensuring that there's captioning in these digital health interventions, which is something that is often at times missed. Next slide, please. Just a preview of the RCT flow, the randomized controlled trial flow. We're not here yet, will be happening in January and early 2020, we hope. But there'll be a screener and baseline assessment, and then participants will be randomized to this culturally adapted Spanish version of Somryst versus enhanced usual care, followed by 3-month and 6-month follow-up. And then I'll just point out that we'll have a rigorous both pre-treatment and post-treatment actigraphy and sleep diary assessment pre- and post-treatment as well. Next slide. And then just in terms of timeline, we're really excited. The cultural adaptation looks like it's on target to conclude by the end of this year. We believe we're in good position to launch the RCT in early 2021 and also to conduct this concurrent multi-stakeholder evaluation. And then to conclude, the RCT should conclude in 2023 and we'll be able to disseminate our study results. Next slide, please. So I just want to acknowledge the multiple funding sources here, including AHRQ and NHLBI, and also the community partners. As I mentioned, I think part of why we've had a lot of engagement and sustainment even during a pandemic is because of the strong community partnerships with various different consulates in New York City who are listed here, including the consulates of Mexico, Dominican Republic, and Colombia, and our community partners like the Hispanic Federation and others here. So I just want, I'll end there, and I can stay on probably till 2:10 or so, Julie. But really delighted to have been able to contribute to today's discussion.
Thank you so much for this amazing presentation. I know it's I'm inspired. I hope you guys are too by all this great work. I just want to mention briefly that we did invite the Congressional Black Caucus to speak with you today, a leadership from that CBC, but unfortunately this forum overlaps with another event that is important. The CBC Foundation and the National Minority Equality Forum is happening this same week. So we are sorry not to have an update directly from the CBC, but we just want to let you know that we are continuing to look for opportunities to further the agenda and the health disparities items that Dr. Granier was discussing, and hope to have more updates for you in the future. So with that, Dean, did we have some, I know,
We got a lot of questions. Dr. Grandner's been answering them fast and furious. To keep us on track, we just encourage folks to continue to use the chat box if you want to keep the Q&A session going for any of these panels.
Okay, all right. Well, thank you again to Dr. Grandner and Alcantara for being here today and doing this special emphasis panel. It is so important, and I just can't thank you enough for all that you were doing. So with that,